very good morning. It's not that early, but it's really wonderful to be back here. And I think Justin and Samir, I need to thank you both for making this event possible. Senator, thank you very much for your warm words. What I thought would be the most useful thing that I could do for all of you is really speak a little bit about how we see the relationship, but more important, perhaps share with you how I see, you know, the Indian landscape changing, and you know why that is relevant for you. And when I say I see the Indian landscape changing, in a way, I bring multiple perspectives to bear. The objectivity of someone who spent a lot of time outside his own country, who keeps looking back at it, and who in a way is a sort of marketing department of the country for 40 years. So you have to know your product well to, you know, to market it effectively outside. And then a brief corporate education, which was, you know, very, very useful, very brief, unfortunately. And 4 years as a practicing politician, and believe me, the speed of education there is even faster. And really, when you go around, I would say, to me, the real discovery of being a politician is how much time you spend really on the road, I mean, on the street, and the kind of things you pick up there, and the impact of changes, which otherwise you look at it much more theoretically if you're just living in a capital city. But let me kind of dial back a bit, look at the relationship itself, and I think I would very much echo what the senator said, which is today's world, I think the state of the world creates a very compelling case for India and Australia to do more with each other. For quite a few years now, for more than a decade, I think we can see the direction the world is going in. It's in transition now. That's a very nice word, which pretty much describes anything at any time. But the bottom line is the sense of stability, the factors of permanence in our calculation that we had for many decades have in the last decade, you know, there have been question marks. And there have been question marks. I mean, we can debate it's a good thing or a bad thing, but it doesn't matter. It's happening. And it's necessary for countries like India and Australia here to work more closely to shape the direction in which the world is going. But there's a much more immediate context, and the context is especially that of the last 3 years. There was already this transition going on, and there were I think, trade concerns, there were financial concerns, and then came the COVID. And the impact of the COVID has been devastating on the world economy. Perhaps we in India and Australia feel it much less. As someone who travels a fair amount to other parts of the world, you know, when we look at Africa and Central America and you know, some other parts of Asia, I look at my own neighborhood, you know, Sri Lanka, Bangladesh, Nepal. You can see really how much damage, economic damage, social damage, psychological damage the COVID has done. And then, if that wasn't enough, there came the Ukraine conflict. So today, I would actually, in terms of foreign policy, for me, one of the big goals would really be how do you de-risk the global economy? And you de-risk the global economy, one, by building more reliable and resilient supply chains, which is exactly one of the initiatives that India and Australia and Japan have embarked on. Two, how do we address the challenges of the digital world much more securely, much more credibly? And there, you know, that's a whole new set of issues and a set of policies out there, which have, you know, it's not without its geopolitical aspects. And the third, of course, what are the important relationships which can serve as stabilizers, really, for a sort of world economy heading into choppy waters for quite a few years ahead. Now, what we are going to see, I think, on the bilateral front, hopefully, is your senator referred to the passage of the ECTA, and I think, in a larger sense, there's the comprehensive strategic partnership, which sort of sets the narrative, the framework, really, for the relationship, and how to take it forward. I think it's hugely helpful to have high-level contacts, to have CEO forums, to have trade ministers. So in the coming days and weeks, I expect to see a lot of activity on that front. And I think it's really when business meets business, when prime ministers meet prime ministers, when trade ministers meet, and even foreign ministers have their role, when we all do our business, in a much more regular, intensive, constructive manner, I think that's hugely helpful to taking the relationship forward. Now, if I can switch track and speak a little bit about how I see the landscape today in India. We have this annual budget exercise. I'm sure you have your version of it as well. And what the budget exercise does is it's like a public stock-taking of the national economy. And not just we call it budget, but actually the budget has alongside it a kind of an economic, an economic strategy and an economic prognosis. For a much longer period than just the year which the budget covers. So they come as a package. The budget, of course corrects every year for that larger picture. Now, since we're just coming out of the Parliament session last week after the presentation of the budget, I would sort of underline to you today that in India we feel that we, relatively speaking, we have come out of the COVID challenge quite strongly. I mean, there's a human cost, all of us know that. I think there's not a single family that I know which hasn't had some kind of COVID loss. But having said that, the COVID period, one, we responded to it in a way in which it was fiscally sustainable. In fact, a lot of reforms were carried out under the COVID stress. There was a lot of creativity, which also was implemented on scale on the field, also because of the COVID pressures. In many ways, I think decisions which may have otherwise taken us much longer, for example, ramping up our health, the resources we devote to health. I think a lot of these decisions really got fast-forwarded. So the sense today in India really is of a certain amount of economic confidence, a confidence also in our ability to manufacture, to create, to collaborate in many more areas. We are targeting 7% growth this year. But we do expect it to improve over the next 5 years, and definitely we think we would stay in that 7 to 9% range at least for a decade and a half. You can in India today see that reflected in the investment climate, in the flow of FDI, FII. As well as in the investments which the government itself is leading, the capital outlay in the budget this year is actually about a third more than it's ever been before. Having sort of made that point that you're really looking at a sort of bullish economic scenario in India. There are a few aspects which I would like to keep at the end of the discussion because I think it might be useful to dilate upon it at some length. But if I were to today move back to our relationship, I mentioned the investment climate because I think if there's one area in our relationship we need to look at more strongly, that is really in encouraging more investments. I think the ECTA would definitely is already having a good impact on trade, but if you know, in a sense, we have to walk on both legs, trade and investment together, because they are mutually reinforcing. So for us, when you know, the CEO forum meets, and when the trade minister comes, and when the prime minister comes, how do we actually encourage greater investments? That is very much a focus for this visit. In our own relationship, I think the mobility migration aspect of it is very important. We've seen a very substantial movement of Indian talent to Australia. We have roughly in the world, roughly about 1 million students. Australia is, I think, purely probably I think third probably a fourth in terms of the numbers. But again, I agree with you. I you know, you said it shouldn't be thought of as a business. You didn't use those words, but that's what you meant. And you spoke about the trust side of it, the responsibility side of it. But I would like to also stress the strategic side of it. Because what we are going to see in the world, we are already seeing in the world, is there's today a great mismatch between the geographies of demand and the geographies of demographics. So where the people need to be is not where the people are, or where the demand is not where the people are. And the last year actually has seen a number of countries actually wake up to this possibility. Just over the last 3 months, I've signed a migration mobility agreement with Germany, which actually has been a very conservative society in terms of flow of people from outside. An even more conservative partner, Austria. We have concluded an agreement for a certain set of professions with Japan. It's been on hold because of COVID for implementation reasons, because we also have to teach them language. With the UK, with France, with Denmark, with Portugal. So one part of the movement of students, you know, the education is something bigger than education. It's actually about the talent and skills which is needed to sustain a global economy. But there's the other part, which today, again, we would like to focus on. It's something which Prime Minister Albanese, in fact, brought up in his first meeting with Prime Minister Modi when they met in Tokyo, which is how do we expand in India the ability to impart skills and education. And we would very much welcome Australian universities in India to do that, because having people move out physically, we are actually not, I mean, we are talking 100,000 people. Frankly, that number is very small compared to what the global demand is. So if we are really going to add a few zeros to that, we need to really get our, you know, act together in India, do it very differently. And we can only do that if it is actually done as a global collaboration. And that's why our new education policy envisages a regime which will allow in India foreign universities to come in some form. My expectation is that there probably will be some further legislation on this subject and some regulations which would facilitate that. But the whole domain of skills and talent is something I think which is very central to this relationship. And for us, it's not just about Indian students coming to Australia. It's about India and Australia working together in India to produce, you know, more skilled, more competent talent for the entire world. Connectivity is another subject. I mean, it's again part of growing a relationship is really having the ability to move. We have an open skies agreement, but it's very clear again that the supply lags well behind demand. But of course, the good news is that Air India has bought 470 planes. So hopefully that should make a big difference to connecting India with the rest of the world. Prosperity in India is also something I would highlight. And I say this coming out of, you know, I've recently been to, and this is completely coincidence, to places where actually tourists go. Fiji, Cyprus, Greece, all this was work, okay? I mean, let's not. But, you know, I put it to you that just as we saw in other parts of Asia, what we saw with Japan, what we saw with Korea, with Southeast Asia, China, as there is greater prosperity and as the middle class grows, you know, middle class is a very broad term, but in our own system, today we would say somewhere between a quarter of India, you know, roughly give or take, would qualify for what we would call middle class. But we expect this to actually become something like six, you know, two-thirds of the country in the next 25 years. And when you have that kind of growth of middle class and the consumption patterns of the middle class and the aspirations of the middle class, I think it's something which any producer of any goods and services which relate to middle class demand should be looking at. And you know, the countries which clearly are early movers here would draw a lot of benefit. Another subject, of course, which has been getting a lot of attention is climate action. And again, if you want to see, you know, big things done on scale, serious things done on scale, India is in many ways the place to be. A lot of the story of the last 7-8 years has been about solar. I think you're going to see a big spike in wind and obviously in hybrid energy. There is now, I think, a growing focus on green hydrogen, green ammonia. And again, this is a global phenomenon. I think one of the unintended fallouts of the Ukraine conflict is a de-risking from fossil fuels. Green hydrogen actually probably has got a great boost because of the uncertainties of how pipelines and production contracts have been leveraged. Now, I'd just like to conclude by highlighting four developments in India, which I think today are very important to understand. Because they capture the change in a way. One, that we have, you know, we use this term, make in India. Make in India is a term which is really meant to highlight the importance of setting up production, of collaborating with Indian companies. It is not autarkic. It is collaborative. You know, we want our partners to come, but we would like them to make in India because we believe we offer a lot of advantages there. And the make in India in many ways is today given a practical shape through in many domains through what we call production linked incentives. So a very, very notable example is the decision by Apple over the last 2 years to shift a lot of their production to India. But in different domains, we really want global manufacturing to look at India seriously. The second is, in a way, an invented in India, that you are going to see more products, more services, more technologies, which are going to come out of India. One example was even during the COVID, the fact that there was, among the vaccines which came out, was a vaccine which was invented, well, more than one vaccine which was invented in India. If I were to pick an example, I think you will get really deployable 5G technology coming out of India this year. Certainly, I think, given what I said about trust and transparency in the digital domain, I think this is something which will be of great global interest. The third pertains to a long-standing problem we have, a complaint about our infrastructure. If you come to India today, physically you can see the infrastructure position change. I mean, you travel in India, go to any Indian city, there's some building going on, there's a sort of an energy and worker bees at it all the time. Here the change has been an integrated infrastructure policy. Now, you might think that's not a big deal, but for us, frankly, one of the reasons why we had not done well on infrastructure was it was done in a very siloed manner. So the railway guys did their stuff, the roads did theirs, the power guys did theirs. So today, the idea that there's a kind of a master plan, you can say, of doing it in a consolidated, collaborative, inter-departmental, inter-ministry, cross-business way, it's something we call Gati Shakti. And that's having, it's actually making infrastructure building, because, some of the challenges are, anybody who's lived in India will understand, right of way, for example, getting the land acquisition done on time. These are the kind of holdups which we've long had, and that's being addressed very effectively. And lastly, if there's a big change in India in the last 3 years, it's the digitization of India. And digitization on a scale and an intensity which is very difficult to communicate if you haven't seen it for yourself. If I were to sort of give you a few shorthand descriptions, during COVID, we were one of the early countries to lock down, but we were one of the countries who locked down most comprehensively. When we locked down, we completely locked down. And the challenge was, how do you feed, what happens to people in the informal economy, people who went back to their homes during this period. So it was a socio-economic challenge, to some degree it was a political challenge. And it was actually the time when the digital backbone was tested. And we had these two programs, one of giving free food, and for till this 31st of December last year, beginning from May of 2020, we were actually delivering free food to a little more than 800 million people. And 800 million people, confident that it was actually going to them, unlike earlier days, it wasn't that it was getting siphoned off, coming into the market, middlemen were taking stuff. The digital was actually ensuring an integrity of delivery and transaction that would not have been possible. Equally, on the financial side, because we had encouraged people to open bank accounts, sometimes bank accounts with no money in them, but we were, again, during the same period, putting in money into the bank accounts of 415 million people who were the lowest income in the country. And if you ask me, how did you get through COVID? I cannot overstate the importance of actually financially supporting people and feeding people and ensuring that this works on the ground. But it's not just the crisis interventions which are a validation. This has now become the basic governance mechanism today to do socio-economic delivery. So if you look we are trying to demonstrate that we can construct a comprehensive social welfare system, even at our scale of income. And our scale of income is $2,000 per capita. And we can do that really by, you know, really cutting the overheads, making sure that in a sense that the programs are very targeted and therefore very, very efficient. So if you look at most of our delivery programs today, the social programs, we have really in the last 4 years been able to get about 500 million people covered by health schemes, about the same number covered by pension schemes. There was a program to replace firewood with cooking gas, and the initial lot of cooking gas you get free of cost. Now that program was as big as 80 million people. We have a housing program. We've already delivered 30 million houses, and at five people a family in India, that means 150 million people have been covered. So I'm giving you these numbers because it actually tells you the scale which digital backbone makes possible. We couldn't have done this 10 years ago because we didn't have that backbone and we didn't have the strategic understanding to activate and utilize that backbone. And you can see this in the lifestyle of people as well. I mean, today, if you look at education, so much of it today is digital. Look at shopping. I mean, we have, in fact, if you look at our cashless transactions, the UPI, I think we record the largest number of cashless transactions in the world. So there's been a kind of a technology leapfrogging in the psyche of people, and that's been actually a very big difference. And it's having, you know, as a political person, I can tell you, you know, when you go to your constituency, you go to other constituencies, you're campaigning. This is really what is making a difference. The nice thing about it, this is actually absolutely faceless. So it relieves the politician of any charge of favoring, you know, one group or one community or one region against the other. I mean, you actually can go in there completely objective, utterly impartial, totally technology data driven, and that's, you know, that's an enormous boon. So these were some of the, you know, thoughts which I thought, you know, I should share with you. My sense is we today clearly got a strong political tailwind. The challenge in any relationship, you know, different relationships work differently. Sometimes business gets a bit ahead. Sometimes you're socially or technologically driven. When I look at the Quad, each one of the relationships has moved with a different aspect of it. Leading. But I would say this for the political side, with a degree of vested interest here, that we have actually led so far, and we have created an environment today where I think the business side, the economic side, the investment side, the technology side can come in much more strongly. And that's really the phase today that we need to be working at. So once again, really, thank you.